It is an honor and privilege to introduce our today's speaker, Swami Suddhananda Giriji. Swami Suddhananda Giriji graduated as an electrical engineer from IIT Madras in 1975. Immediately after that, he joined Bhabha Atomic Research Centre in Mumbai. After serving in BARC for 5 years as a part of the research team experimenting in plasma physics, he felt the inner calling to dedicate his life as a monastic disciple of Sri Paramahansa Yogananda. Therefore, in 1980, he joined Yogoda Satsanga Society of India to disseminate the scientific Raja Yoga teachings, the spiritual treasure of ancient India, for the balanced development of body, mind, and soul, as well as to render humanitarian service to the downtrodden and the needy. Since then, Swami Suddhanandaji has been living in YSS ashrams at Ranchi, Dakshineswar and Noida. He is a member of the board of directors and is currently serving as the treasurer of YSS. He has addressed diverse groups, students and faculty in eminent colleges and universities, professionals in engineering, healthcare and other industries, and those serving in our country in military and government establishments. He has traveled all over India and abroad, giving discourses on the how to live teachings of Yoganandaji that bestows all-round success and complete fulfillment. It is our great pleasure to have him here with us today. Therefore, without any further delay, I welcome Swami Suddhanandaji to address the gathering.
Good evening, everyone. In the present context of globalization and interlacing of various human activities, it is no longer tenable that knowledge be studied and acquired in watertight compartments. We have to overcome set ways of thinking and prejudices and welcome knowledge coming from different quarters so that truth may be established. We are very happy that IIT Chennai is doing exactly that by inviting with open-mindedness persons from various disciplines so that a scientific spirit can be inculcated among all through constructive exchange of ideas and innovations. I am personally happy, being an ex-electrical engineer engaged in research, now coming to you in a different garb to share with you a few points which may help the budding scientists and technologists. Being a product of this eminent institution, I am doubly happy to be here after more than 4 decades. Actually, after I passed out in 75, this is the first time I'm coming here. I shifted gears from doing research on electrical power generation. You know, it was a special project called MHD, magnetohydrodynamics, where we use the plasma and with superconducting magnet, we generate DC power, electricity, and then that drives a turbine in the regular thermal power, you know, method of thermal power generation. But then the project later on, I heard it was abandoned because economically it was not viable. But I was very happy to be involved in that in the beginning stages. So from electrical power generation, research on electrical power generation, I shifted gears to spiritual power generation, which integrates and enriches various dimensions of whole being. My search for truth resulted in finding the teachings of Paramahansa Yogananda. It is here in IIT Chennai. I spent a few years pursuing enlightening literature. I used to frequent the central library, and especially philosophy department, metaphysics department. that is where I used to frequent quite a bit. And also trying to do social service in nearby villages in addition to my course. And it is here, as the final year student of electrical engineering, that I found the book Autobiography of Yogi. I saw firsthand how a fellow student, it already went to the next slide. A fellow student who was a drug addict, how he was completely transformed. I asked him what happened to him. He read Autobiography of Yogi, he got inspired. Then he started practicing meditation, learning these techniques which Swami Pavitrananda described in brief. Just in a few months, he got so much inner strength that he kicked the habit. So I was really amazed. So I took the book from him first time. Later on, I took the copy from the library. We had a few copies in library at the time. So for me, so this institute is very special because this is where I found the teaching which enriched my life. This book sheds light on many facets of truth, the purpose of one's life, and how should one conduct its life, his life or her life, in this world to remain calm and unshaken amidst challenges of the fast-paced modern living to achieve his or her goal. No wonder many world-famous celebrities from different fields, such as you had just now seen, Virat Kohli, Steve Jobs, George Harrison, etc., Ravi Shankar, they all recommend this book to one and all. Also, great souls like Paramacharya of Kanchi, Swami Shivananda Saraswati of Rishikesh, Mahatma Gandhiji, they have paid high tributes to the author and the institution he founded. Okay. Now, first I want to start today dwelling on what is real success, because the topic is meditation, key to success. So first, some thought-provoking points from some modern leadership management trainers. Okay. First, a book, small book, Gung Ho. Some of you may have read this. One of the co-authors is Ken Blanchard. He is the author of 1 Minute Manager. It's a very interesting book. You may be a little bit intrigued are surprised by seeing what is all this. There was a company, unit of the company in America, that was in doldrums. And from the head office, one person was transferred there on promotion. You know, we heard the term punishment promotion. We get promotion actually in order to get rid of that person. So this lady was transferred to this unit because along with the unit, she will also go away from the company. When she went there, she thought she was getting a promotion and very happy. And she found that it was going to close down. It was not doing well at all. But in that company, one department, quality control department, was doing very well. That was headed by an American Indian. And from him, she learned why that department was doing well. Because he learned from his father, observing nature, a few important lessons he learned in life. One, spirit of the squirrel. How squirrels, you know, they gather food during summer, springtime, so that in winter when food is in shortage, they have got enough food stored. So they got a purpose, worthwhile work. Whatever we do, why we are doing the work, you know, to have that understanding of the purpose. Second, the way of the beaver, that is in control of achieving the goal. Many of us in India may not know the beavers. They normally stay below culverts and they build dams very fast. And you may see that there's a lot of chaos. Everything is moving around here and there, rodent family, you know. But then each one their own share. Each one, the allotted share. And nobody trots on the other person, interferes with the other person. It's a beautiful teamwork. So this is what way of the beaver, in control of achieving the goal. If you have got a goal, you just concentrate and focus. Third, but just having a goal and knowing the purpose is not enough. We also require spirit. Without spirit, you know, then it is there is no value. So third is gift of the geese. You know, the geese, when they fly, seven of them, they normally form a V formation. And scientists have studied and seen, when they have that formation, the efficiency is 71% more than individually what they would achieve. Because, you know, that special aerodynamic effect and so many things are there. But main thing is, they all take turns and they keep on honking and cheering the leader, all of them who are behind. It's a very fascinating thing. You can go through that. Later on, you can study yourself. But then here the point is, just by studying these three things, spirit of the squirrel, way of the beaver, and gift of the geese, gift of the goose, this company was turned around. These principles were taught to all the managers of various departments. The company turned around so much, it won President's Medal. The company which was going to be closed down, it became number one company in USA. Very surprising, isn't it? You please read that book. It's fantastic, fascinating book. Why I'm quoting this? To show that we have to live close to nature, observe nature closely, and learn, and then practice. Now, I'll give you another one, which may be of great surprise to many of you. That is, so Gay Hendricks is one of the authors. The book is called The Corporate Mystic. You may be surprised by with the term itself. Mystics are in spiritual side and religious, you know, traditions. How can a corporate be a mystic? But then he has done extensive research, and he is one of the, I mean, they all train leaders for the leadership roles. And he says very boldly, 21st century leader has to have all these qualities. You may be surprised to read all this. Absolute honesty, fairness, self-knowledge, a focus on contribution, non-dogmatic spirituality. They get more done by doing less. He gives an example. So one apprentice, he joins, he observes the leader of a company, spends half a day. And he was surprised. In half a day, he was able to do what he would do in 1 week. And it appeared as if he was not doing anything at all. So, because many times we see people who seemingly they do a lot of things, running around here, there, and very busy, but achieving nothing. We have a joke. They are called NATO leaders. No action, talk only. So, we normally see people who are running around and doing a lot of things. But those who achieve, they're very quiet and efficient, you know. So this is a wonderful thing. I mean, this quality of being relaxed and calm and in control of things, then you can achieve much more. Then they call forth the best of themselves and others, bringing out the best from us and bringing the best from others. Openness to change. You are flexible. You are able to adjust. Special sense of humor. That's also very important. Then keen distant vision and up-close focus. That means a balance between role and goal. What is the goal we have to achieve? What is the role I have to play now? Perfect balance between these two. Because otherwise, if you are goal-oriented, but you are always thinking about the goal, what you should do now, if you don't focus on that, you can't achieve. You have to be practical. But if you are too practical, just very busy doing things, you don't know where you are headed, then you are in trouble. Then, unusual self-discipline, balanced life. So you are surprised, isn't it? These are the qualities required for the 21st century leader. Why I brought that? Because now I come to success, as defined by modern management experts. Many of you may have read the book, 7 Habits of Highly Effective People by Stephen Covey. There he talks about 4 generations of management. First generation management, simple to-do list. I have to do this, tick, tick, finished. Then you are successful. Second generation, priority-based. You prioritize them, those tasks. Which is to be done first, which is to be done later. But then the third generation, all this developed over many years. I am describing it together, but then it all developed over, evolved over many years. Third generation, value-based management. Values are assigned, and those are the things you achieve, you accomplish. Fourth generation, principle-centered management. That means there are definite cosmic principles. There are principles existing in the cosmos. If you recognize them and align with them, then you are a successful person. And if you don't align with those principles, though you may have wealth, you may have prestige, I mean, you may have name, fame, and success in the outer sense, but really you are not successful. So this is not told by some rishis or, you know, some religious person. This is told by modern management gurus. So that's what is so surprising, isn't it? Now I will tell you the definition given by Paramahansa Yogananda about success. It is what you have achieved within that determines success. If you are happy within, then you have success. How can you be happy? If you are in tune with the cosmic laws. Your life is in harmony with the cosmic laws. So success is not measured by the ordinary standards, worldly standards of wealth, prestige, and power. None of these bestow happiness unless they are properly used. So now you see, both modern management and Paramahansa Yogananda, the success, it's really surprising, isn't it? They all point out to the same thing. Now I will give you the definition or the explanation given by Paramahansa Yogananda about all-round success. How do you achieve all-round success, real success? Living a balanced life leads to all-round success. We need to balance all the dimensions in our being, of our being. Living in harmony with the principles governing the cosmos through development of material, mental, and spiritual nature, which means, explaining it more detailed way, to have good health. You have to keep the body fit, efficient. If the body is not healthy, then any moment you want to achieve something, body doesn't cooperate. Then you can't really have a successful life. So you have to master the body. It should give you, render service to you whenever you want, reliably, efficiently. Second, to have prosperity. This is a physical dimension is over. Now we come to next dimension, to have prosperity. To be prosperous is not wrong. You know, one may think that, so here a sannyasi is coming here talking to us, he will tell us we have to renounce everything. You should not pursue, you know, you should not be successful in the outside world. That is not true. Real success means you are successful in all fields. So it is not wrong to be prosperous. But when you are selfishly prosperous, when you are miserly, you are thinking about only yourself, then that is where the problem is. If you share that with others, help others also to become prosperous, as you become prosperous and you help others, then it is good. Next is to have harmonious human relationships. So I have a lot of success in my field, but I have problems with everybody. Then that is not real success. Though I may be a genius or brilliant person, I may be doing well in my field. You know, you all may have heard the term emotional intelligence. So in this book, I have read one incident. There was a topper from MIT or some, you know, eminent institute, IT guy. Yeah. And companies were all vying with each other to recruit him. And one company hired him. After a few months, they fired him. Why? Because he had so much pride. He was thinking so highly of himself. He was looking down upon others. So the teamwork, it would not function in the team. So company had to, you know, just fire him after that. This shows very clearly that one has to have developed the skill of dealing with others. Then to have well-defined purpose of life, lost. So now you see physical dimension, intellectual dimension, mental dimension, emotional dimension and spiritual dimension. All the dimensions we have to pay attention. We have to, then only we become really successful. When I joined here in IIT, my seniors told me, don't become a mugpot. So give time for doing exercise, keeping your body fit, cultural activities, extracurricular activities, give time for all of that. I thought, how on earth I can do that? We have got so much, you know, so many things to do. I can only study. I can't do anything else. I thought it was impossible to do. But after some time, few months, I slowly started managing my time. Somehow I managed to do good time management. I used to get up very early. Then later on, I used to go for a jog. And from my hostel, I was in Godavari hostel many years. Then I used to run, you know, all the way up to the gate and then go back. It's about 3.5 kilometers like that. And I found that because of that, I was energetic throughout the day. It was so good. It, you know, I got that initiative, and when I practiced, that's why the institute is special for me, because it's not just only academically that you learn your subject. You also learn to balance your life with other things. So this campus is very conducive for this purpose. So now I'll just talk about yoga meditation. Yoga bestows freedom from all suffering and leads to all-round success. What is yoga? So it's a very deep subject, but I will cover some aspects. First, quotation from Bhagavad Gita, chapter 6, 17 sloka. Yuktahara viharasya, yukta cheshtasya karmasu, yukta sopnava bodhasya, yogo bhavati dukkaha. Which means, with regularity, you eat and, you know, and abstain from eating. Not too much of feasting, not too much of fasting. You have a balance. And you don't relax too much and you don't work too much. You don't sleep too much, you don't remain awake too much. This balance. So with this balance, this is a part of yoga that becomes the means for destroying all suffering. Yogo bhavati dukkaha. Completely, you know, all your sufferings are finished after that. So this is a wonderful definition of that. But then, now we will talk about why we cannot lead a balanced life. What is disturbing us? What is causing the problem? We'll go to the root cause, try to analyze. When you direct all your attention on the outside world only, through the 5 senses, we interact with the world and we just focus on that only, always. That is the main reason. We probably, many of us would not have thought like that, because we are so busy catering to so many things in the outside world. We don't even think of turning the attention inside. So that is why, to put it in a very simple way, in contrast to the outer technologies that enable us to harness the energies, in our external environment, our rishis and sages had discovered inner technology, the science of controlling the energies of life and consciousness. So this inner technology has to match with the outer technology. This is a balance. So that if our attention is always on the outside world, so then we are going to be in trouble. So we should know also what is happening inside. Who are we? Discover the inner dimensions. That is why Paramahansa Yogananda has given a curriculum, how to live training, that's called, for all-round self-development. Just only 4, very simple. Science of body care for practical efficiency. We don't neglect the body, physical dimension. That is proper diet, exercise, rest, all that. Control of energy, all that. Second, mental engineering. It is so relevant here. We are an eminent technological institute. Why he uses the term mental engineering? Normally thoughts are intangible, isn't it? They are like sort of theoretical. But how to make the thoughts work for you practically? That is engineering. So we have like civil engineering. We have a drawing on the board. We think about it. We have the idea, plan. Then we have to actually implement it and erect the building, which is practical. So engineering is something practical, where we have to do things, practical results have to come. So mental engineering means the thoughts have to be put to use, that we have to develop our willpower, for example. This is one of the facets of our mental side. If we develop the willpower, then we become master of our own mind. We can direct the mind wherever we want, you know, that way, and control over the moods. Normally, many times we find that we are under the influence of the mood. If our mood is not good, we say, abhi to, now I am not feeling good. Right now I will not do. Later on when my mood changes, then I will do the thing. So then we become a slave of the moods. Our recent discoveries in medical field and science, psychology, indicate that moods are created by our thoughts. So if you want to change the moods, you have to change the thoughts. So if you change that, then like recent developments in neuroplasticity, for example. Now previously it was thought that when you are born, by heredity, our brain, you know, it comes with hardwired, that we can't change. But then now, recent research indicates that, no, we can change. By our thoughts, we can change, even the neural circuits can be changed. So these are all mental engineering, you know, it's a very vast field. I just put it together in one, you know, this under this heading. Third, social arts. This I already explained a little bit, that emotional intelligence, when I explained about it. So this is how to get along with all sorts of people. So people may be at very different levels, different capabilities, how to deal with them. I will tell you one small story, which will make it, you know, a little bit easier for you to appreciate and understand. Paramahansa Yogananda, when he was traveling in America by train, so in that compartment, just in front of him, there was a movie actor. This movie actor was a little bit, he was saying, what is a strange fellow with a turban and, you know, the strange dress. So he had a little bit of disgust, you know, in his face. He was expressing, he didn't say anything. Then Paramahansa Yogananda accosted him and said, sir, why are you wearing such a harried expression on your face? Why don't you paint a smile on your face? Like that. So he said, what an audacious person you are. You mind your own business, leave me alone, you know, like that. So then immediately he wanted to get up and go somewhere else. But Paramahansa Yogananda, like a mother correcting a mischievous child, he caught hold of his hand. He told his sir, please wait, soon we'll have a good understanding of each other. Then he made a remark. Do you know, in this world, each one of us, we are a little bit crazy. And we don't know it. Then he very cautiously, you know, he was agreeing. Because that means that he is also crazy, he is admitting that. Then Paramahansa Yogananda continued. He said that, do you know why I say that? Then he said, why people don't see their craziness? Because people of the same type of craziness, they mix with people of similar kind of craziness. Then we said, we are all fine. You know, we are all same type of craziness, we mix. But when you mix with different type of people with a different type of craziness, then you discover your own craziness and the craziness of the other person also. Then he said, okay, let us have a discussion, not argument, discussion. He said, fools argue, wise men discuss. So let us have a discussion and I'll try to convince that my type of craziness is better than yours. Then you follow me. And if you convince me that your craziness is better than mine, then I will become a movie actor and follow you. So he had a good sense of humor. He said that I was saved from becoming a movie actor. Because, you know, that he got finally convinced that his craziness, that craziness for this all-round development and balanced life and, you know, finding purpose of life and seeking God, all this, that is better than his craziness, which was just one-sided, you know, just becoming a movie actor. So he followed Paramahansa Yogananda after that. So why I told this story, we have to deal with all sorts of people. If some people, their vibrations don't match with ours, then immediately what do we want to do? We want to avoid them. We don't want to interact with them. Or sometimes we even hate them. So that's how all sorts of troubles and problems everywhere start. Whereas when we learn to see the speciality in that person, like I was created by God with some speciality, the other person also has been created by God with some speciality, so why not I look for that speciality in that person, rather than being put off by the outer behavior or that obnoxious things which I observe right now. So you have to penetrate that outer mask and go to the core, inner side. Then you will be able to find, you know. So this requires a lot of skill, a lot of development. It doesn't come just like that. That's why social arts. Fourth one, applied spiritual science. So spiritual science, but it is applied, practical. That means we are not talking about only philosophy and theories. We have to have direct experience. Like when you say God, God is peace, God is love, God is joy. We have to experience that. Then you know, yes, that's correct. Otherwise, you only think about God in general terms, and we have all concepts, so many types of conceptions, and we all get confused. But when we directly experience, all confusions clear away. That's why it's applied spiritual science. So which means we have to discover that inner dimension. How do we discover the inner dimension? It is by quieting the outgoing mental restlessness, by turning the mind inside, within, which is very difficult to do. Because normally, mind is programmed when you are born to be focused from inside to out. Our attention is always on the outside, baharmukhi. Baharmukhi se andarmukhi karna. We have to turn that attention inside. Turn. So that is what yoga does. So final line, last line, Paramahansa Yogananda says, the beauty and depth of yoga lies in its bestowal of this invariable tranquility. That means we achieve the inner harmony. So outside harmony and conflict and everything you'll be able to handle when you are secure in your own inner happiness, in your inner calmness, which will not be disturbed by the outer things. So meditation takes us to a higher state of consciousness where peace, just reading these things give us so much joy. Peace, tranquility, serenity. Sorry. Okay. Peace, tranquility, serenity, equilibrium, balance, strength, harmony, love, clarity, understanding, wisdom, and joy. See how many things really will be, I want all of that. I want each one of these. Surely we will say that, isn't it? So meditation gives us that. It takes us to this higher level of consciousness where we achieve all this. So now we'll have a meditation break. So we, instead of tea break or coffee break, we'll have a meditation break. That means all of us, let us try to experience a little bit of this meditation. Because meditation is quite deep. It's a deep subject. Right now we'll practice very simple meditation, which is necessary for those who want to learn Kriya Yoga, for example. This simple meditation will be very helpful. These are all practiced by everyone. So three things, please observe. One, keep the spine straight. This is the most important thing in meditation. Because our cerebrospinal axis, it contains subtle centers of energy. Subtle centers of light, the finer energies, prana. So if we keep the spine straight, then the energy flows very, very easily. Otherwise, there are obstructions. The energy cannot flow properly. That is the main reason why we keep the spine straight. And second, keep the body relaxed. No tension anywhere. All the muscles are just loosely hanging. Just you can think of like your spine is like a rod. And around that, the flesh is hanging very, loosely. That means you feel like a jellyfish, for example. Jellyfish, you can think of that. So your body, it may not come right time, first time when you just try. But we'll practice one or two small things to get that relaxation. Third is, this is something for some of you may be strange. Both the eyes have to be lifted up, focused on point between the eyebrows. This is called the Kutastha center. So we just lift your eyes up, focus here at this point, which is to be done without strain. That is why it's difficult. So if you do a lot of strain and focus here, you can't really meditate. Meditation means you have to relax. So if you are straining, you can't really go deep. So it takes time. You have to practice. Today you learn a little bit. Then if you make it a point to practice regularly, twice a day at least, then after some time you'll find become easier and easier. So this is very important to do that. Eyes should be lifted up. You can have a long focus. If you find it difficult to focus straight away here, look at 30 degree angle or 45 degrees angle at a distance and then close your eyes. You can keep them half closed if you want, if you find comfortable. Otherwise, fully closing will be better. But when you fully close the eyes, make sure your eyes don't come down. You know that when we don't practice, what happens is naturally they will come down. There's a natural tendency. So we have to give training so that eyes remain up, they don't come down. This is a very important point for meditation, deep meditation. Because when the eyes are down, we tend to go to sleep state, subconscious state, we go to sleep. When the eyes are level, we remain in the waking consciousness, jagrat avastha. When eyes go up, then we go to turiya avastha or superconscious state. That's why keeping the eyes up is very important. Even if you do that, I told one computer engineer in Dakshineswar, he said, I just do this, immediately I find so much of calmness and concentration. Just by keeping the eyes up, you'll find that. So just keep the eyes up, body relaxed, now spine is straight, okay? Now what we'll do, just take 2-3 deep breaths, long breath and long breath, just exhale. As you exhale, relax the body further. Do it 2-3 times. Now, in order to relax even more, what will you do is, I will give you one technique given by Paramahansa Yogananda, which is very powerful. First, you just tense the whole body by making fist also, whole body, by taking long, slow, deep breath. Go on breathing, inhalation through the nostrils, and tense the whole body. Now, exhale through the mouth quickly, one short, one long. Just throw the breath out. Once more, take the breath slowly, inhale. Exhale quickly through the mouth and relax the whole body. Let us do once more. Okay, now forget the breath. Just remaining at the kutastha, at the point between the eyebrows, what we are going to do, we are going to become an observer, sakshi, witness. Just observe your own breath as if it belongs to third party. You are watching somebody else's breath. Just let the breath just go in and out. Don't interfere. Don't control. Let it just come and go. Just watch. Natural breathing. Just watch it. You have to become aware. Be aware of the breath coming in. Be aware of the breath going out. That's all. Don't interfere. Let it just come. You are aware of it. When it just goes, be aware of it. When it doesn't want to flow, just enjoy. Don't force it. Let us do just for 2-3 minutes like that. Just let the breath just come and go. You are just to be an observer. Just take one breath and slowly expel that through the mouth or through nostrils. Slowly expel. After the breath goes out, don't take another breath. As long as you can comfortably sit enjoying the breathless state, just enjoy that. Then take another breath. Slowly expel. Remain without breath as long as you can comfortably hold that. Repeat once more. One breath taking, slowly expel. Then enjoy the breathless state. Now we'll go deeper. At the point between the eyebrows, just imagine a spot of light, a small spot of light, which is full of joy, joyous light. Just imagine at the point between the eyebrows, just a tiny point. Now, we are going to expand mentally by imagination. This spot is expanding. It is filling the whole face. Whole face is covered in that light, beautiful light, white light. And we feel quite happy, joyous. Forget everything else. Just concentrate on this. Now expand further. Whole body is filled with this light. So this expansion should not break. You will continuously, you should expand. Like pulling a rubber band continuously, similar to that. Now from the body, expand and feel all of us in this auditorium. We are all filled in this light. Every one of us. Expand further. Whole of IIT campus is covered in this light. In this way, let us go on. Further, now whole of Chennai city is in this light, bathed in this light, immersed in this light, floating in this light. Further expand, whole of Tamil Nadu, then whole of India. Further expand, whole of Asia and the whole world, globe, is floating in this light. Beautiful light, white light. In and through is the light. Further expand, our whole solar system with all the planets revolving around the sun, the whole solar system is bathed in this light. Further expand, all the stellar systems, our Milky Way and other, you know, galaxies, all of them, they are all floating in this light. So this expanded cosmic light, Virat, that is our real nature. Now open your eyes, look at the body. How small, how tiny this is. What a small thing this is. Close your eyes again. Now you think, I am not this little body. I am the infinite light, which is spread everywhere, all over the universe. I am this light, I am not the body. I am this light, I am not the body. Think for a while like that. Om Shanti, Shanti, Shanti. Thank you. Now you all experienced a little bit of that. How you see so many of us are in this auditorium, but then when we are doing this meditation, how wonderful it felt. What vibration we felt. Tranquility, peace. Some of us may have felt even joy, deep joy also. Just a tiny bit of meditation can give so much. So, if you make this a part of your daily life, morning and evening, what a tremendous change it will bring in your life. That is why today's topic, we wanted to have this practical thing, importance of meditation. How that is the key to success. So now, Kriya Yoga meditation is the special form of meditation where we use the technique, scientific techniques, to control the prana, energy, which is normally going outward, the direction is changed. That means the prana starts flowing inside. So this is possible because being an electrical engineer, you know, for me it's very nicely I can understand. So when in the spinal axis, the south pole of that magnet, spinal magnet, is the coccyx center or the Muladhar, and the upper, the north pole is the Kutasa center, Ajna Chakra, the top portion. So in this magnetic field, when you circulate the current, then like the BH curve, you know, like that. So this is going to become magnetized now. As we circulate the current, this magnet is going to become more and more powerful. So day after day, when you practice, it's become more and more powerful. Finally, it becomes so strong when you cross the threshold, when you, you know, when you reach a particular critical point after that, then you will feel all the currents, outgoing currents, they are just drawn inside. Because the magnet is so powerful, outgoing currents are drawn inside. Then you find it's augmented further. Magnet becomes even stronger then. Then you reach a state called pratyahar. Pranayama, this is pranayama, where you control the energy. Pranayama is not just simple breathing exercise, which is control of the prana, life force, where which can use. Breath can be used in that. But in Kriya Yoga, all the three things are used. Breath, mind, and prana, life force. So using these factors, then we achieve scientifically a state of interiorization, pratyahar, where we are detached from the outside world. This is not something strange. This is natural. Every day when you sleep in the night, what do? We are not aware of the body. We are not aware of the external world. Where do we go? We retire within. We just retire into our spine. The consciousness goes inside. Then we are connected with God, the universal consciousness, cosmic consciousness. We are connected with that. That is why we feel fresh after we, you know, after when we get up, we are again charged. Like a mobile phone, when it gets depleted, we charge it again. So God has given us, every one of us, this method of recharging. But this happens in an unconscious way. We are not aware of it. Our rishis and munis had discovered long before by doing research that why not we do that in a conscious way? That is Kriya Yoga. You know, now you can understand how that works. But there's a dual thing. We have got to play a dual role. One is, in this way, detach yourself from the outside world, go inside, discover the divinity, discover that you are connected with the universal consciousness. Then we have to play the role on the outside world also. That means each one of us, we have our part to play. Discover what is our part and how to play it properly. You know, that is also very important. Then only we have the balance. So that is why in meditation, here also, we find the last sentence says, one finds his instant guidance. His means God's, the Supreme Spirit. Spirit's instant guidance. Adequate response to every difficulty. Any type of problem, any issue you want to solve, anything, just retire within, become calm, your intuition will start working, because intuition develops when you become calm. When your mind is restless, you are identified with the external world, intuition doesn't work properly. It may work even now, even then, little bit, but not reliable way. But when you detach yourself from the outside world, reach the interiorized state, get that calmness, then intuition works very well. That is why you become calm, detach yourself from the problem, detach yourself from the issue, all the conflicts, you know, reach a state of harmony. Then you take the problem and what is the solution? Very clearly you will be able to see then. Much clarity will be much more. Because we have seen many scientists have discovered, for example, their discoveries, breakthrough. They struggled and struggled and struggled, nothing was coming. They forgot the problem and, you know, just relaxed. Then suddenly that solution starts coming. Why? Because intuition actually started at the time manifesting. So, but Paramahansa Yogananda says, we can scientifically, reliably develop intuition. So the method is regular meditation and reaching calmness. So, but then Kriya Yoga also has another ingredient, that is devotion. Devotion means yearning. That is, we want to do that. And suppose, because, you know, that it's a very deep subject, I cannot cover it in this small talk. But then you can call it as yearning of the soul to know the truth. Yearning of our own inner self to know what is truth, who I am, to know that. So this yearning is the devotion. So that yearning is required, plus the scientific process is required. Both together, we get the solution, we get the achievement. So Paramahansa Yogananda has given now that inner-outer balance to remember that simple formula. To be calmly active and actively calm. What is actively calm? Which means it's a dynamic peace, not a passive peace, not a static peace, which is a kinetic peace, a dynamic peace. Peace which is alive, which is living, which is not something which is, you know, which you don't know what it is. You know also clearly what it is. Consciously you are aware. So that is being actively calm. This is what we do by meditation. We actively experience the calmness. Then, next challenge. How we can hold on to that calmness and peace and joy, whatever we get in meditation, as we engage in the outer activity. Because very fast we find, okay, we have done meditation, we got a little bit of peace. The moment we come out of meditation, in a very short time, everything is gone. We find that, you know, somebody says something or something happens, triggers, and, you know, our mood is gone and we start fighting and all that. Then we suddenly discover, oh, what happened to all this? Everything is gone. We all start like that. Every one of us. We should not be disheartened by that. As Swami Pavitrananji mentioned from the Bhagavad Gita interpretation of Paramahansa Yogananda, we have within us two sides, the Kauravas and the Pandavas. Kauravas are the bad guys. Pandavas are the good guys. We have both within us. Bad guys, they are trying to take us to shortcuts and, you know, that you don't have to do all this, you don't have to put up with all this discipline and all these things are not required. You can just achieve through, you know, all these very shortcut methods and this and that, whatever. So many. That's why Kauravas are many, 100 Kauravas. We have so many bad, you know, bad things. They are pulling us down. Pandavas are only 5. But then, who wins the battle? It depends on us. That is the problem, you know. We have been given a choice. We recognize who are the bad guys, who are the good guys, and who are ruling in my consciousness, in my kingdom of my mind. Who is ruling now? Who is the power, more powerful? How do we know? We have to do introspection. Bhagavad Gita starts with that only, the very first answer. Dharma Kshetre, Kuru Kshetre, Samaveta, Yutsavaha, Mamaka, Pandavas Chaiva, Kima Kuruvata Sanjaya. The blind mind, Dhritarashtra, is actually everything is symbolic in, you know, the Bhagavad Gita, this Mahabharata Yudh. It's not just a story, which is something practical, relevant to each one of us. This is what you will discover. Those of you who are interested, please go through God Talks with Arjuna. You will see that, how this has been described so vividly. In practical life, every moment we are having this battle, conflict between the good guys and the bad guys at different levels. Physical level, emotional level, intellectual level, spiritual level, metaphysical level, everywhere. The fight is going on. If we don't recognize it, then we are pulled down by whatever we are accustomed to, whatever we are habituated to. Our habits dictate. We don't have free choice in that case. But we have the free choice. How do we discover that? By introspection. That is the scientific method. We introspect and sort out all the good tendencies and bad tendencies and find ways how to change the bad to good, transmute the bad emotions to good emotions. Is that possible? Yes. Through meditation, we get the power to do that. So introspection plus practical application through meditation. So that is why calmly active is a very big subject. So very simply described, to be calmly active and actively calm. If we do that, we discover the secret of success, real success. Now, just for us to have the proper perspective, each one of us have been created with the uniqueness I mentioned. Our rishis have expounded in the Vedas to whatever extent we can grasp with our intellectual ability, because intuition is the highest power, but normally we use intellect. We don't use intuition much. So whatever we can understand with our buddhi, with our intelligence, our rishis had expounded. They said that each one of us, we have been created with uniqueness. That uniqueness is in a potential form that is to be brought out. We are given chance for that life after life. And normally, we take a long time to develop that because we have got so many distractions and so many things to take us off. So we have to become clever. We have to be focused. What is my goal? What should I do? You know, that focus on that and achieve, which is very difficult. Spiritual adventurers are very few. But then this is what we need to do. We have to do that. We have to bring out that uniqueness. Then only purpose of life is fulfilled. So we got a dual role. Retire from everything. Go inside. Discover our divinity. Second, bring out the uniqueness which is within us. So when we try to do that, all sorts of obstacles come. We all become very tense and nervous and you know, all sorts of problems come. That's why I will close this talk by giving you 10 practical tips of how we can become tension-free. How we can really face the situation in day-to-day life in a very positive way. So these are very simple things. They may sound too simple. But then you see, if we really practice, they really work very well. First one, you have to practice meditation every day, twice at least. If you can practice more, it's good. Because when you practice meditation, you get calmness, isn't it? So naturally, if you have tension, you just detach and relax and meditate. Then you find you become calm. So keep the mind calm through the practice of meditation. First point. Second point. Think one thought at a time. So one may think that, oh, this is old-fashioned advice. Because nowadays we have multitasking. Computers do so many things at the same time. Why shouldn't we also should be doing that? But actually, if you analyze the computer, if you go deep, what is the basic circuit in a computer? Simple binary circuit. Given the input, output is 0 or 1. With that simple binary circuit, with the different combinations, we create logic and we create the huge supercomputers and they do, you know, dazzling things. Basic level, what is happening? It's a simple circuit only, that much only. So similarly, what is the basic thing we have with which you work? Thought. So if you focus the thought on just only one thing at a time, you can achieve tremendous things. I will tell you a little story, illustration. A very busy railway station in USA, in New York, Grand Central Railway Station, where trains are, you know, leaving from different platforms every minute, within a minute, even two or three also sometimes. Imagine the person who is sitting in the enquiry counter. Unka halat kya hoga? What will be his state? He is a good candidate for getting burnouts. Morning to night, people are bombarding him with, you know, asking questions. We normally easily, you know, criticize such people who are, you know, they don't answer anything, they don't do, etc. But if you really put yourself in that person's position, you see, morning to night, people are bombarding with questions. Naturally, they will become very flustered and they can become very tense. But there was this one fellow who was very cool. He was not at all flustered. He was calm, relaxed. So this one psychologist was in the line and he was very surprised. How come this fellow is like that? So he wanted to find out the secret. He waited for the crowd to thin out. Then he asked him, "Sir, please tell me, you handle so much of crowd and you still remain so calm. How is it?" Then he said, "Crowd? Where is the crowd? I don't see any crowd." He said, "I just focus on the one person who is standing in front of me asking the question. So the moment I answer him, I repeat again. If he doesn't understand, then off. Then I concentrate on the next person. That's all. So I see only one person at a time. I'm handling only one person at a time. You see, it works or not." So we have. That's what we need to do. Normally what happens? When you are playing, we think about the problem in our subject. Or when you are studying, we think about family problem. So if you just focus on what we are doing, when you are doing, you know, enjoying, recreating, just enjoy. When you are studying, just focus on the study like that. Then you will be able to achieve much more. You know, I'm a fellow student in my year, electronics. He was in electronics, I was in electrical. I was in low current, high current, he was in low current. Then he got the president's medal. He was a number gold medalist. And you know, it would appear as if he was not studying at all. He would be just relaxing and not doing anything. How? Whatever he did, he was completely focused. In the class itself, you would, you know, cover the subjects are all already, you would have already grasped so much of it. So as I told you before, they seemingly do less, but they achieve more, similar to that. He was so focused. So this is an ability we have to develop, how to concentrate. If you really concentrate, what takes about half an hour, you can do in 5 minutes. It's a really marvelous thing. So developing this, using meditation is very practical also, you see. And also you should learn this method of thinking one thought at a time, time management, thought management, more of that. So that's why I will not go too much into that. I think that much will be enough for you to understand. Next is, this is also something strange. Don't interrupt others while they are talking. Let them finish their sentences. So normally what happens, we are so much in a aggressive mode or whatever, we want to achieve our targets, or we are so much focused on our own. If somebody wants to say something, we have no time. So we cut off the other person. We just say, oh, this, and what we want to say, we say and go on like that. So in the modern life now, with all the, you know, that our remote, when we use for controlling the channels, TV. So how you go on challenge, so fast we keep on changing, attention span is so less, is becoming less and less. So this type of impatience prevents us from doing that. And in the process, we get very tense. That's a final product. Whereas when we listen to somebody properly with empathy, not just sympathy, empathy. Empathy means you put yourself in other person's position and try to understand that person. Walk in other person's shoes, as the saying goes. So if you do that, then you find you become tension-free. There's a effect of that. Next, read books that require deep concentration. Again, similar principle. When we read books which stimulate your thinking, we have to think deeply to understand. Go deep into the subject. If you read just trash, then at that time you feel thrilled. But afterwards you feel completely miserable. You are not happy at all. Your peace is gone and you are disturbed. Whereas when you read books which requires deep concentration, what happens? You become tension-free byproduct. Because, you know, when you are focused on something, then you forget other things and you become relaxed. Swami Suddhananda Giri is our general secretary. He is an alumnus of IIT Kharagpur. He did his PhD from there. Recently, IIT Kharagpur honored him as distinguished alumnus of the institution, where the president of India also was present. When Swamiji just shared for 2 minutes something from that institute, just like I shared a little bit here, similar to that, he said he learned there what is focus. He said when he was doing research, some algorithm he was developing in electronics ECE, then he said that after breakfast, he will just start. He will just look at the clock, already 12 o'clock. He started at 8 o'clock. He opened his he was so focused, he didn't even look up to see the time. He just look up, it's already 12 o'clock. So you see that is how the focus was. Then what will take 3 years or 4 years to do research? He finished in within 3 years, within 2 years, in fact. So how did he do that? Because of the focus. So if you read books that stimulate your concentration, you'll get that ability, how to focus, how to get that concentration. Plus you become tension free, byproduct. Learn to eat slowly, next one. This, you know, my common joke is, even fast food should be eaten slowly. Because you know that as per nature, we have to cooperate with the nature and understand how the body works and, you know, do accordingly. So when we slowly eat and masticate the food properly in the mouth, 50% of the digestion happens there. Otherwise, the stomach is overloaded with too much of, then we get into all sorts of disease problems. So this is very important. Simple thing, but we need to practice that. Next, exercise regularly. This I already shared with you my experience. How by, you know, the doing everyday regular jogging, that helped me a lot. So make use of this facility in this campus. And you can do some sports or swimming or whatever you like. Paramahansa Yogananda says every day engage in some vigorous exercise so that we sweat profusely. If we do that every day or even once or twice, whatever, or a few days in a week, and you will see that how you become really fresh and you learn lead a balanced life. Next one, recreate, learn to enjoy simple things of life. This is again my common joke. Those who heard my talk, I'm repeating again. You know, there was a research scholar who was staying in a apartment. Then he was doing research in his department. So somebody asked him on the way, did you observe such a wonderful thing? Some flower is there, nice flower or something else. He said, no. I walk from apartment to department and I walk back from department to apartment. I don't see anything else. So normally we become like that so much, too much, you know, narrowly focused. Then we forget to appreciate, enjoy simple things in life. They will give us a lot of joy, happiness, relaxation. So it's very important to recreate, learn to enjoy simple things of life. Then relax, similar to that. Don't get bogged down in little things, you know. That when it is a time for you to do something, do it. Like for example, those who are being trained for football, hockey, badminton, anywhere, the coaches, they will tell you. When you are learning, you learn skills, technical skills, how to handle. Like a batsman is learning how to handle the ball which is coming. So he has to learn many things, study and all that. But when he's actually doing it, forget everything. Just relax and do it. Isn't it? Then only you will be able to do properly. At that time, if he's thinking all sorts of things, oh, should I do this? Should I do that? Then you will get all confused. You can't do anything properly. So when you are actually doing it, you just go with the flow. Just let it, you just do. But then before that, you prepare yourself, learn everything, then you can do that. So this is what is meant by don't get bogged down in little things. Next, set aside time for seclusion when you can be alone. That means if you require some course correction, how do you know? You are just simply go on like a mechanical living. And suddenly you find where I am going, what is happening in my life. You have, in order to control your life, what you need to do? Take time to think. When you can just relax, when you observe silence, detach yourself from others, from your routine, you just shift, move away from the routine. Then you can think for yourself and study, introspect and see what corrections have to be made. You know, this is a scientific way to make. You know, I will tell you one interesting thing. When Concorde flight was introduced between London and New York, a reporter was, you know, taken to the cockpit to just show how the various controls and everything. Then he was told, the pilot told, that 99% or whatever high percentage of time, the flight is not on course at all. That means there is a continuous course correction. It is nothing like, you know, perfectly the chart, the route is set and exactly you are just going to follow. It's not like that. You are off, corrected, you go this side. Off, corrected, this side. All the time fine-tuning, it keeps on happening. So our life also same way. It's very dynamic. Just because today I had a nice time, peaceful time, it doesn't mean that tomorrow will be like that. So new problems, new challenges, when they come, we have to be prepared for that, to handle that. So how do we do that? Then when you have time to be alone, we think, introspect and see. A new situation has developed. Think, okay, now my situation is different. I have never handled this. What I am going to do now? How shall I manage it? So when you really think like that and take the help of the universal intelligence or God, whatever name you want to call, by meditation, then intuitively you just understand how I should do the course correction or how I can, what decision I should take now, you know. So that is why this is very important. Once in a week, suppose you take a few hours, start with that. That much can be done easily, half a day, for example, in a week. Last one, keep the mind fixed all the time on the pole star of divine presence, which means our connection with the universal energy, universal consciousness. That connection has to be kept alive. It's not just something passive. It should be done, you know, actively. This comes by making an effort. All the time think about the goal of life, purpose of life, is to discover who I am, is to discover my connection with the universal intelligence. This is what our Upanishads and great scriptures, they all tell us, Aham Brahmasmi. I am one with the divine. I am not ordinary human being. That's why somebody put it very beautifully. We are not human beings having occasional divine experience. We are divine beings having human experience. We don't think like that normally, isn't it? We don't think of ourselves as divine beings. We think that we are just ordinary human beings. We are too much concentrated on the biological things which are happening outside. But actually, it's a very we are complex beings. We got many dimensions. But the core, at the core, there is utter simplicity. That is a beauty. You know, now many scientists are discovering that. The string theory and other new theories which are being developed, you see that there is utter simplicity at the core. Even Einstein's law, you see, so simple that is. E equal to mc square. Just very complex things, he just simplified with that. So similar to that, when you go to the root level, you see things are very simple. But the simplicity develops into utter complexity. So what we need to do? We have to discover the unity in diversity. We have all the diversity, we have to discover the unity within that. This is our challenge. So it is possible to do. Through meditation, we get direct experience. Then we know that it is not just a theory, it is actually I can experience that. You will be able to get that more and more. Thank you for patiently listening.